sometimes people ask me what kind of subject geography is. And then many times I have, instead of trying to answer this difficult question, I have suggested people to read William Mead's book, An Economic Geography of the Scandinavian States and Finland. Of course, I think that's a marvelous piece of work which actually shows what geographers try to do. Today, we have the pleasure to welcome at Lund the author, Bill Mead, and we will have an opportunity to ask him a few questions about his life and as a geographer and his ideas about the discipline. Well, Bill, could you tell me first, how did you come into geography?
Well, I don't think this is a very easy question to answer. I believe these things grow out of very remote experiences in one's childhood. I certainly think back to all sorts of experiences which happened before the age of 6 or 7, as far as I'm concerned. I could be very specific. One of my earliest recollections is going for walks in the countryside and having every tree and flower and bird and animal pointed out to me and named by my father. Of course, they weren't named with the Linnaean names. They were given the usual English country, I suppose, Anglo-Saxon names, because I imagine that I am an Anglo-Saxon by remote ancestry. So that these features of the countryside, and not only trees and plants and flowers, but rocks too, because I was brought up in a little bit of the English countryside where there are a number of different formations which lie in juxtaposition. The family farm which my father sprang from lies on the watershed between the Thames drainage and the Ouse drainage to the Wash. High, dry, windy, heavy clay, sticky clay. Then we moved to the chalk country, and between the chalk country and the clay country there is green sand rock, which I remember, but above all I remember the fossils which we used to try and find in the little patches of the oolitic limestones. One of my earliest recollections is looking for fossils. But even before all that, I remember something else. It's strange how these things happen to you. When I was very small, it was the days before the motor car, of course, and we moved around by pony and trap. And we used to drive in the countryside, around the countryside, in a pony and a little cart. And there were still quite a number of gated roads, as we call them in those days. The roads which went through fields where cattle grazed, and then there were swing gates which you had to get out and open and go through. And there was one particular bit of country we used to go through, which we used to call the switchback road, or rather the switchback field. And it used to be a great pleasure for me to get my father to take the pony and trap off the road, onto the grass, make the pony go fast, so that we went up and down over the green switchback of the grass field. It was, of course, ridge and furrow. And little could I appreciate that more than 30 years later I should find myself deep in the ridge and furrow controversy with W.G. Hoskins, who was one of the great British local historians who came and lectured to us literally on this subject at the University of Liverpool. These are two things.
Yes, yes. Was your father a farmer?
My father was not a farmer, but the whole of the family on both sides were farmers, and he was the only one who wasn't.
I see. What was he?
Well, he had to leave the family farm. There were seven brothers there, mm-hmm. and it was only possible for two of them to take over. So he and one of my uncles were apprenticed to a corn chandling and grocery business. So we weren't very far removed from the countryside. And I remember when I was very small how the produce from the family farm used to come in and go out through the grocer's shop on the one hand and the corn chandling business on the other hand. So it was one step removed.
Mm-hmm. But he had still retained an interest in the land and its resources. Now, did you remember also the people and the activities as a child? It was not just the nature.
No, I remember it very well because I remember my father showing me how to use a scythe for grass mowing, and he was full of stories of what one might almost call pre-industrial revolution farming, because certainly when he was a boy, the whole of the family farm was harvested by scythe, not by mowing machine, and he used to speak in terms of six or seven of the village labourers coming and hiring themselves literally to cut the hay harvest independently of the grain harvest. Oh, many many stories from those remote days.
Now, when did you encounter a more academic form in geography? Did you have that in school?
In school, of course, and we had two very fine teachers. I went to one of the old grammar schools, which I still believe to be the best schools in England, but we won't go into that subject. We had an old grammar school geography master who was an ex-naval commander, Commander Jenkins, who had travelled the world, who had no real academic geography at all. On the other hand, he had seen everything with his own eyes, and he used to paint very graphic pictures of distant places. When we grew older and a little wiser and read things like A Midsummer Night's Dream, I remember we used to be very rude about him and talk about our geography masters taking us on a trip round the world like Puck, you know, in 40 minutes. Then we had a new young man come from University of Nottingham. Maurice Seven was his name, in fact, and he was absolutely splendid. Though, in retrospect, I know, of course, that he simply read to us the lecture notes that he'd had in his university department in Nottingham. But he came to us at just the right time, because he picked up the subject in a much more academic manner. Those two. But I was not really interested in geography, ultimately, in my school.
No, I noticed that actually you went into economics when you came to the university.
Yes, because I wasn't brought up properly. You see, I was very interested in the French language, and I gave up Latin. And, of course, you could not go into an arts department of geography in pre-war years in England unless you had Latin. As a subject for admission.
Oh, yes.
Certainly. We mustn't talk about that now, but there are other stories hang there. And I had given it up and stuck to French, which I'm very glad I did stick to. And I read French as easily as I read English today. Mm-hmm. And I don't mind telling you that today I believe that French is the real language of geography.
You think so?
Yes.
Now, let's come back to that later, perhaps. Now, but you started your university studies
in economics. That is perfectly true, because I couldn't read English literature since I hadn't got advanced level in Latin. But of course, I was continually interested in literature. Yes, economics, which in those days embraced theory of economics, naturally banking, currency. Economic history, which got me in a very big way. We had a wonderful lady lecturer, Eileen Power, whose little book called Medieval People, published in the Pelican series, I read to this day. She was absolutely marvelous. And then I did two courses in geography, one on Europe, which is the part of the world I really am most interested in. And I do remember Dudley Stamp's lectures on Europe. He was awfully good.
Was that part of the training in economics, to have some courses in geography?
It was not compulsory, these were optional. And I took two special courses, one in economic geography and one in geography of Europe, because Dudley Stamp was already quite a figure, and people went along to hear him automatically. This was in the middle 1930s. I must just say one thing. He was the first person, this is going to anticipate something else, he was the first person I ever heard give a lecture on the geography of Finland. And it was not in that course. It was, in fact, to the Geographical Association and was printed in geography. Very good it is, too. He used the only unexceptionable adjective that you can apply to Finland. Amphibious. Amphibious Finland and the amphibious Finns. I thought that was marvelous. I still think it is.
I see. Now, speaking about Finland, you somehow were brought to an interest in Scandinavia, and particularly Finland. Was that later, or how did it come about?
Well, it came about in an odd way. I've told you that I was really interested in literature.
Yes.
And I spent much of my undergraduate time reading respectable fiction and a lot of poetry and so on. And when doing the course on Europe, I didn't read the geography of Europe. In those days, of course, one simply had one lecture, one country, and one went around the European scene. I simply found a book in translation from the literature of each of the countries concerned and read it. And some strange things I read too, which still stick in my mind, as you might imagine, from those days. There was no trouble with Norway. There was Ibsen, you see. Yeah. I had a tremendous thrill out of Johannes V. Jensen, The Long Journey, which I actually bought. That was the book I read when we came to Denmark. It was Strindberg for Sweden, in fact. Mm. What for Finland? There was just about nothing in translation in English. There were a few things in French. The only thing in English was Kalevala, of course, the folklore. And I remember going to North Wales at Easter with George Borrow's book Wild Wales in one pocket and Kalevala in the other pocket. And that really, quite seriously, is the beginning of my interest in matters Finnish, because I was already interested in music, and I was already quite attracted to Sibelius, you see. And of course, as you know, the Sibelian tone poems take their names from Kalevala, and there it all is tied together already in the middle 1930s.
Did you already at that time make a connection between art, say literature and music and so on, and geography?
Oh, very, very much so, very much so, for all sorts of reasons. I remember being much attracted by, one has different interests in music at different stages in life. In those days, of course, it was the romantic and above all the tone poems that interested me. I thought I could see landscapes naturally in music. I mean, after all, you know, Dvorak and Flutter and so on.
Yes. And so on. Yes.
But I've moved away from all that, of course.
It could be a period in one's time.
Very important, I think.
Yes, yes. Now, did you do the same kind of reading for other European countries?
Oh, yes, indeed. Yes,
so Italy and France and Spain.
Yes, it was not in Scandinavia alone. No. I remember Poland. What could there be from Poland? Well, yes.
Sienkiewicz.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I see. Mm-hmm. Was this still before the war?
Well, this was before I graduated in the middle 30s.
Uh-huh. Yes. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. And when did you take up actual geography studies in the geography?
Seriously?
Yes.
Well, it so happened that one of my farming uncles died in 1937 at a very strategic time and left me the sum of £500, which was quite a lot of money in those days. And, of course, there were no university scholarships. There was, in fact, one at the London School of Economics at that time, which, as far as I remember, in my year went to David Glass. And so if one wanted to do postgraduate work, one had to pay for oneself, of course. Now you know, of course, in England today, all the best people are in receipt of grants from the Social Science Research Council without any problem. And £500 saw me through 3 years, comfortably, fees included. And I really wanted to read economic history under Eileen Power, but so did everybody else. And I'd always been a bit interested in geography, so I thought I'd swing over and do something in geography. And I went to see Hilda Ormsby, who was the specialist on France at the London School of Economics in those days. It was a very small geography department, of course. And she agreed to take me on. And she said, what do you want to work on? So I said, something to do with Scandinavia. She said, of course, I know nothing about Scandinavia. She was a specialist on France. But then neither really did anybody else in the geography department at the London School of Economics. Then I had to narrow it down to a part of the world I could afford to go to, of course, and also to a part of the world which I thought no one had worked on. Mm. Nearly made it Norway, nearly. But then it seemed to me that quite a lot of English people had worked on and were interested in Norway, so I eventually decided upon Finland.
And it was taken for granted at that time that you should go to the area?
No.
It wasn't?
No, but I took it for granted that one had to.
Yeah, I see. So
yes. So in 1937, the autumn, I registered at the London School of Economics, and I was interested in matters rural, and I thought it should be something in the rural field in Finland, and I was thinking of something on Finnish agriculture. I knew not what.
No, that's interesting, because then you had not in mind to make a general regional study, but you were thinking of specializing into some...
Very much. But then it was quite clear to me that this was not going to be a possibility, because I had no Finnish language at all, and one could only do this if one had some Finnish. And we talked about the matter with my tutor, and eventually I decided that I would switch from matters agricultural to matters commercial and deal with some aspects of the geographical background to Finland's foreign trade. Because the statistical material was available, and it was available in Swedish as well as in Finnish. And just at that time, I encountered a little group of postgraduate students at the LSE who were rather anxious, for all sorts of reasons, to learn Swedish. So I joined them. There were five of us, in fact, to begin with, and we paid to have a special teacher to give us some Swedish lessons so that we could all get along in Swedish. And Finland being bilingual, officially, you see, everything of an official character in the commercial field was in Swedish as well as in Finnish, so that overcame that problem. But you can begin to see that the whole approach is now being rationalized. Mm-hmm. It was completely fortuitous to begin with, and mildly emotional, and then one moves over from the subjective to the sort of rationalization at stage two.
Now, and when did you go to Finland?
1938.
So already before the war?
Of course, yes. And very cheap it was. £10 return from Hull to Helsinki, food included.
So you went by sea?
Yes. And it was about the cheapest country in Europe in those days.
Was this your first visit to a foreign country?
Oh, no.
You had been to a foreign country?
Oh, yes, yes. Yes, but never, of course, people did not go to Finland in those days.
Was it a little bit of a cultural shock? Do you remember how?
I remember it very well indeed. I should never forget the heat. This was the first shock I had. I hadn't expected to find it so hot. It was subtropical with thunderstorms throughout the 3 or 4 weeks that my brother and I were there. The cultural shock came in the context of the cheapness of everything. 223 Finnish marks to the pound. We ate in the best, as students, we ate in the best restaurants in Helsinki, you see. We stayed in hotels. I think one, a student, one student
almost like Americans in Europe after the
war. Yes, exactly. And then I really was struck, we really were struck by the primitiveness of many things, indeed, when we moved up into the Lake District, of course. It was rather like going back to, pre-war situation in rural England, I suppose. One encountered so many of the things that one remembered from both childhood. As I remember going around in horses and carts in central Finland, you see, in the late 1930s.
What actually did you do then in your field work? Did you take contact with professional geographers in Finland, or with ordinary people, or did you just
go out?
In those days,
it literally was getting a feel of the country. Because as far as my first written work on Finland was concerned, it was a master's dissertation. It was not supposed to be fundamentally original. It was a dissertation, not a thesis. Mm-hmm. And it was based upon statistical material. Mm-hmm. Interestingly enough, the essence of it was printed in Torun, in Poland, in a journal called Baltic and Scandinavian Countries in 1938, as an extended essay. And I had occasion to look at it again about 6 months ago in quite another connection. In retrospect, I think it had a point or two. An interesting point or two. I was particularly interested in Anglo-Finnish commercial relations. And that, of course, brought me into touch with the Anglo-Finnish Society in London, which was another matter.
Did you meet some of the geographers
in Finland at that time? No.
So you
didn't meet any geographers at that time. My first Finnish friends were the Finnish students who were in London and younger people at the Finnish legation, as it was in those days, and some of the younger people who were trading with Finland, all of whom became rather important people in the post-war years.
Now, then came the war. Did you spend the wartime in the army?
Thereby hang many tales, of course. First of all, I finished my first piece of work at the LSE in 1938, and of course it was a question of looking for a job. And I began to cast my eye around, and there was a vacancy in the Department of Geography at Hull. And my tutor said to me, "You don't want to go there. You wait a little longer and you'll find something much more interesting." So I waited a little longer, and of course the war broke out. And everybody was in a state of complete chaos, and I still had £100 or so left out of the legacy. So I re-registered at the London School of Economics for a PhD, and went in a state of evacuation to Cambridge. So I then had a year at Cambridge. I volunteered for the RAF in November 1939, but the queue was so long that I really wasn't called up until the end of June 1940. In the meantime, of course, there came the Finnish Winter War, which upset me quite a lot, of course, and sent me with my pen to paper, as a result of which I wrote two papers on Finland, one for the Geographical Review and one for Geography. One was called Finland in Winter, that was for Geography, and the other one was really on the political position of Finland based upon Olaus Magnus's Carta Marina, and they really both sprang out of the Finnish Winter War. I had a very interesting series of experiences in Cambridge at that time of a purely Finnish character, which have led on to all sorts of post-war experiences. Then, of course, 1939, I went into the Air Force, not flying. In fact, I was entirely on the administrative side.
And you stayed in England?
No, indeed not. I tried hard to get to India.
Yes.
But I hadn't sufficient influence, so to do. I was very interested in India. And then I was completely frustrated because I was sent to help occupy Iceland. But that thrilled me a lot, because I tried to go to Iceland in 1939, and I could only afford to go tourist class, and there was very little communication with Iceland in those days, and there were just no accommodation to get there. So I came to Denmark, and indeed to Skåne instead, in 1939.
Did you?
Yes. but only just for two or three weeks holiday. And then it was really an irony that the first thing that should happen to me during the war was that I should be sent to Iceland. I think I was the only happy person on the boat.
you were actually...
I was in Iceland for 3 or 4 months, as a matter of fact. And then from there, I was sent to Canada, which did not appeal to me in the slightest. I was very annoyed indeed. And for the first 3 months that I was in Canada, I cut myself off completely and spent all my spare time reading everything about Scandinavia. And then I thought, how silly. And I wrote to Reiford Watson.
Yes. Was he then in Canada or in...
He was in charge of the department at McMaster.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And said, can I come and see you?
Yes.
I thought it was time to take up geography again, you see, because by this time I had neglected geography for nearly a year. And that was the beginning of my real interest in Canada. I had long talks with him. I spent every spare moment that I had reading about Canada and going back into all sorts of 19th century journeys.
Had you an opportunity to travel?
I traveled quite widely in Canada, and I automatically called on geographers wherever I went, whenever I had any leave to do this sort of thing. But it was with Reiford that I spoke most and discussed matters most. Though I remember a marvelous discussion with Griffith Taylor in Toronto.
Oh yeah.
Absolutely wonderful. He was just like a long-legged spider going like this, fetching out reprints from here and books from there. And absolutely marvelous.
Now, a parenthesis, what do you think of his kind of geography?
Well, of course, I found it immensely stimulating. He was a man of great imagination.
Yes. Certainly.
Great imagination.
Certainly.
And he was a fundamental field worker. After all, he went south with Scott.
Yes. Oh, he did.
Of course. Among a number of geographers who did, but that's another story. I must just say one thing about Canada, and my Canadian friends don't really like this. I felt that one had to make an effort to meet French Canada as well as the rest of Canada. And I did make a very great effort to go to French Canada and to Quebec and to meet people at the University of Laval, particularly
you
historians.
You were already French-speaking at that time.
Oh, yes, there was no problem at all. And I got one of the professors of history at Laval University to introduce me to one of the habitants farmers, and so that I could go and spend a leave on one of these old French Canadian farms. I'm afraid my English Canadian friends in Ontario didn't really approve of this.
Oh, but it's different now, I suppose.
No, it's worse.
Is it worse? That's terrible. Mm. Now, and when the war ended.
I should really just pursue the Canadian theme for a moment or two. I became enormously interested in Canada and indeed wrote my first little paper on Canada with Reiford Watson at that time. And then eventually I came back from Canada and was posted to an extremely interesting unit in Salisbury, just outside Salisbury. Marvelous piece of countryside. There we helped a bit with the planning of the invasion of Europe. So the maps came in a very helpful way, of course, in all this. And I became enormously interested, since I lay for a while with my head on the chalk, I became enormously interested in the antiquity of the area around Salisbury. I'm not thinking of Stonehenge, but I'm thinking of the multiplicity of antiquarian sites all around on the chalklands and the medieval churches in the valley. When I was in Canada, I wrote long letters once a month. I mean by that 10 or 12 single-spaced typewritten pages, a round robin letter to a group of friends, and they passed it on from one to the other. So I have a complete record of my journeys around Canada. When I came back to England, I did the reverse and sent long records of my activities and appreciation of the Hampshire countryside back to my Canadian friends, and I kept carbon copies of all those. And that bit of England, which I moved over in very great detail, really began to appeal to me in a very great way indeed. But that that was the end of my war, really. Then I became a free man rather earlier than most people, because I remained registered for my PhD at the LSE, and of course I kept pushing on with little bits. It was a very peculiar PhD, not very good.
What was it about?
Well, I was very interested in Scandinavian unionism and Scandinavian integration. Mm-hmm. It has some points, I really didn't know anything about it. It was all right. It was really a kind of politico-historical geography.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, my examiners thought it was tolerable and let it through. At which stage, many things happened. I had to get a job, of course. Reefer Watson telegrammed and asked me to join him in Canada.
He was then not yet in Edinburgh?
No, he was still at McMaster.
Yeah.
I said yes. And Reefer knows that Gordon East said to me, "Why on earth do you want to go to Canada?" And then he sowed seeds of doubt. And I cabled back to Reefer and said, "I think I better have second thoughts." Then Gordon sent me to Arnold Toynbee. So I nearly became a civil servant.
Toynbee, the famous historian?
Yes, yes.
Was he in the civil service?
Oh, he was in charge of the research department of the Foreign Office throughout the war.
Was he? And still there after the war?
Yeah. Oh, yes, at that time. Uh-huh. They wanted someone in the Scandinavian department.
Uh-huh.
So I had a very interesting interview with Toynbee. And I was appointed to that department.
So, in a sense, you were working in intelligence service somehow?
No, not at all. The research department of the Foreign Office was not concerned with intelligence as such. It was much more concerned with the historical background to critical circumstances. And it was a matter really of advising on behavior and so on.
Diplomatic?
That kind of thing, very much diplomatic matters. Well, naturally with Toynbee, they were almost entirely historians who were working there.
Did you come into closer contact with Toynbee?
Oh, no, well, I only met him 3 or 4 times.
Yeah, so you were not influenced
No. Oh, of course, I knew it very well.
Yeah, that's right.
I read it very well from cover to cover at a later stage. No, I got cold feet because I didn't want to be a civil servant either.
No?
Eventually, I started applying for jobs on my own. And I remember applying for a Swedish government scholarship and a Finnish government scholarship through the British Council. And a vacancy at the University of Liverpool and one at the University of Southampton. And happy to tell you I was offered all of them. But the moment I walked into that nice old house in Liverpool in Abercrombie Square, which was full of atmosphere, like your nice house in Lund, I knew that if I was asked to go there, I would just go.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all there was to it.
Mm-hmm.
In those curious days, of course, assistant lecturers were interviewed by 6 or 7 people round a table, wasting their time.
Uncomfortable exercise.
Appointing assistant lecturers.
Yes. Yeah.
Dare I tell you one silly little thing? It does have relevance. My tutor in London said, "Don't let them get away with you too cheaply." So when they offered me £400 a year, I said I didn't think it was very much. And the dean of the faculty of arts rose in his chair and said, but money? Money? We don't talk about money if we come into a university. I spend all my time talking about money these days.
Yes. Oh, that reminds me of a story I came across when Helge Nielsen asked me to be an assistant. Mm-hmm. And he offered me a free room in the department. My first question was, well, how many hours a week are you going to work for that? And he got angry. Said, we don't ask that kind of questions. Well, so it must have been
the same attitude.
The same attitude, yes.
Well, there were two things that tipped the balance. Three things.
In the department, my first question was, well, how many hours a week are you going to work for that? And he got angry. Said, we don't ask that kind of questions.
Well,
so it must have been
the same attitude.
The same attitude. Yes.
Well, there were two things that tipped the balance. Three things. One, the atmosphere, and I'm very, very sensitive to atmosphere. Two, I'd never met him before, but it was clear to me that Clifford Darby was a person I would be interested in working with. And three, Clifford said to me, well, don't worry too much about the money. I'll get you some money to go to Finland during the long vacations. Then, of course, it was a question of what was one going to work on. And he said, you better stick to Scandinavia, and you better find a subject. And I nearly made it Norway. But then I thought, that's silly, let me stick to Finland. And then I really moved over to Finnish agriculture in a big way. But what aspects of Finnish agriculture? Well, I went out in 1947 to visit Helmersmeds, of course. And we began to talk about things out in Vasa Sjergård. Marvelous week out there with him. He knew every little detail. And of course, we lived with farmers, and I began to sniff around the lie of the land. And then, of course, I was familiar with what had been happened in respect of the displaced Karelian farmers, and it just passed through my mind that that might be the area which might be something for me. And then I moved from the Vasa area to Savolax, and was happily introduced to Finland's grassland expert at the time, who was a very helpful man with already well-established English connections, and I spent a fortnight with him and moved around among displaced people who were literally clearing the land at that time and began to move forward into that area gently. And 48 back again, 49, by a series of entire accidents, the social sciences secretary man of the Rockefeller Foundation happened to come to the University of Liverpool straight from Finland, where he had given the sociologists a very substantial sum of money to investigate the resettlement of displaced people. And I had a little chat with him because he learned that I was interested in Finland and said, what would you do in Finland if you were given the chance to go and spend a year there? So I said just the right thing, of course, without knowing it.
Now, so in a sense, you started with a problem.
Yes.
A well-defined problem. Mm. But gradually you moved over to a much more general, regional approach with a very strong historical perspective on it. It's interesting because most people, I think, in our generation would have stayed with a speciality and perhaps narrowed it down rather than go over and broaden it into a general geography. I wonder just what you think about this whole problem. To me, it's obvious that this sort of thing is, after all, what geographers should do. But how do
some geographers?
Well, really, clearly. But how do you think we can get back to a philosophy which makes this kind of work possible again? Because for the moment it is, for young people at least, very, very difficult. What is your experience?
I think that one can't really do this kind of thing until one becomes a little older. I'm very self-conscious about doing this kind of thing. The fears that I have felt about this in retrospect are quite horrible. I think I was much too bold in attempting to do that sort of thing. But coming back to it, you see, the first page is the interesting thing in it. All the critics miss all the most important things, of course. But then that's just one of those strange facts.
To a philosophy which makes this kind of work possible again, because for the moment it is, for young people at least, very difficult. What is your experience?
I think that one can't really do this kind of thing until one becomes a little older. I'm very self-conscious about doing this kind of thing. The fears that I have felt about this in retrospect are quite horrible. I think I was much too bold in attempting to do that sort of thing. But coming back to it, you see, the first page is the interesting thing in it. All the critics miss all the most important things, of course. But then that's just one of those strange facts. That would be my judgment if I were criticizing the thing. How did the first page begin? It began through Wooldridge, you see, who used to call me a man suffering from otherwhereitis on the one hand, and used to call me a gasworks and cabbages man on the other hand. Because only geomorphology was respectable, of course. And he said, who are these economic geographers? What do they do? Are there any such things as the principles of economic geography? Of course there aren't, he said. There's principles of geomorphology, but no principles of economic geography. Go away and write them down.
Well, we got that with the whole this whole business of the theory of location and so on. Doesn't work.
I went away and wrote down what I thought were the principles. I'm not talking about laws. Principles aren't laws, you see, because I don't think there are any laws as such. There might be some principles. So Wooldridge, I really was so sort of challenged by all this that I went away and wrote 800 words. And the essence of those words are in the paragraphs 3, 4, 5, and 6, or thereabouts there, you see. And then one moves, but I think that one wants a kind of thesis to a thing called a book. A book is not a collection of chapters. And this is what I'm struggling with at the moment, to write the introduction to an historical geography of Scandinavia so that there is continuity in it, so that there are certain themes in it, so that there is even a very elementary thesis in it. And it must have a concluding chapter where one draws all these things together. It doesn't stop in thin air.
You see this almost as making a composition where you have certain themes and the whole thing is logically connected into a whole.
Ideally, I do, and that is what a book is, as distinct from a collection of chapters. That is not a very good book, because the structure was not completed. The publishers insisted that they had it before I completed the thing structurally.
I see.
It was two-thirds completed, and then the last few chapters were not did not follow the model that I had in mind, because I wanted a general picture with very concrete illustration from a particular economic field of study. But I never got my particular examples in all of the chapters. In most of the chapters, there is the general economic geography of the particular systematic field, and then there is a specific study attached to the general thing.
I have noticed here that you go up and down between micro cases and more broader discussions. Are you by any chance influenced by Platt in this respect? His Latin America book is built on...
I didn't take anybody's book as a model.
No, but had no particular influence from other authors.
Not at all. I'm very much interested in going up and going down. This is something, in fact, which Clifford Darby thought of very much. He thought that everybody should concern themselves with very precise, detailed specialisms on the one hand, but on the other hand should have a generalist interest. And he believed, and I too believe in this, that everyone should have a systematic competence, but at the same time should not lose sight of the whole. And I believe beyond this that they... And I too believe in this, that everyone should have a systematic competence, but at the same time should not lose sight of the whole. And I believe beyond this that they should have an area interest, what in the old days was called a regional interest, as well as a systematic interest. But this, of course, becomes increasingly difficult in an age of specialization and in an age when geographical techniques become a necessary part of the training of geographers. You see, technical training in our days, my remote days, was a very simple matter. It was simply map reading and, of course, a bit of surveying and a bit of projection work and so on, which was, I suppose, mathematical geography in the best sense, if one may speak in terms of mathematical geography. But once one did not follow the model that I had in mind, because I wanted a general picture with very concrete illustration from a particular economic field of study. But I never got my particular examples in all of the chapters. In most of the chapters, there is the general economic geography of the systematic, particular systematic field, and then there is a specific study attached to the general thing.
I have noticed here that you go up and down between micro cases and more broader discussions. Are you by any chance influenced by Platt in this respect? His Latin America book is built on...
I didn't take anybody's book as a model.
No, but you had no particular influence from other authors.
Not at all. I'm very much interested in going up and going down. This is something, in fact, which Clifford Darby thought of very much. He thought that everybody should concern themselves with very precise, detailed specialisms on the one hand, but on the other hand should have a generalist interest. And he believed, and I too believe in this, that everyone should have a systematic competence, but at the same time should not lose sight of the whole. And I believe beyond this that they should have an area interest, what in the old days was called a regional interest, as well as a systematic interest. But this, of course, becomes increasingly difficult in an age of specialization and in an age when geographical techniques become a necessary part of the training of geographers. You see, technical training in our days, my remote days, was a very simple matter. It was simply map reading and, of course, a bit of surveying and a bit of projection work and so on, which was, I suppose, mathematical geography in the best sense, if one may speak in terms of mathematical geography. But once one talks of areas, one must have languages. And these are another matter altogether. And many, you see, by the time a geographer has become a geographer with technical competence and systematic competence, he's into his 20s, middle 20s, too late to learn languages. You don't do
unless it. You do it already before in school, at least part.
But you don't do it in school anymore. It's too hard work.
It's a pity. Yeah. But there's another feature here which has not just the language is an instrument, but you have so much. That made so much use of literature.
Oh yes.
Poetry even, and
of
so
course.
On. It's to me it appeals very much to see this mixture of very precise mathematical graphs and poems. And so you use every sort of means of expressing things, but it's not very common. But you obviously make a point in doing it like that.
You have a Swedish geographer who has recently written Away with Equations, Up with Poetry, or words to that effect.
Is that Gunnar Olsson?
How could you guess?
Well, but that can easily go too far.
Yes. That's true. Yeah, yes. That's true. On the other hand, the two cultures have to be kept together.
Absolutely, yes. Now, I think it's time now that we take up the question of the future, and that is very much related to student teaching. Mm. How would you like to see students introduced into this area? Because what you say is necessary is to have a specialization and at the same time to be a generalist. Mm-hmm. You must know an area. Mm-hmm. That's very much. And in which order do you think one should introduce students to it? Or should one try from the beginning to follow on?
No, I think one must begin with systematic and technical considerations, really. But already in the second year, of course, specialize systematically and aerially or regionally. But I think really the volume of knowledge that students are expected to acquire from the background point of view demands that there should be a broad spectrum of geographical information given in the first year. Now, of course, the thing that I'm very conscious of is that students don't look at atlases anymore. Students are not really concerned with maps anymore. The globe, what is the globe? I can honestly tell you that I'm the only person in my department who in the span of 30 years has ever used a globe in a lecture room. Because you see, I wasn't allowed to lecture the first year until quite recently. But now, when I go in to give my first lecture to the first year, and I'm still only allowed to give 5 lectures to the first year students, I have my technical assistant carrying the globe in front of me.
Yes.
And we have a map of Mercator on the wall. We have a map of Mercator, and we have the globe. And I make them look at the globe. And I talk about the things we talked about 30, 40, 50 years ago. How do you make that round surface flat? Then we start talking mathematics. But they don't know any of these things anymore. They know nothing. Of course, you see students in British grammar schools where they teach very good geography still. The bright young teachers, of course, introduce them to 3 volumes at a time on time and geography and so on. But then the students will come in not knowing there's any link between time and longitude, for example. It's most extraordinary. But the other point, of course, is that nobody knows where anywhere is anymore. And this is a very worrying thing to me, because at a purely practical level, when 3-year-old university geographers go out into the commercial and managerial world, as most of ours do, let alone into the world of teaching, into which only a small minority go anymore, they are expected to know where places are, and they are the people to whom their colleagues turn for information about places and locations.
Mm-hmm.
Rather worrying.
Now, it's difficult. I think it could be quite confusing to a student to see this immense range of interest.
Yes.
There is the globe on the one hand,
yes.
And there is a little tiny locality on the other hand. There is the question of general thinking, perhaps principles and so on.
Indeed.
And there's the question of factual knowledge.
Indeed.
I mean, it's an immense task.
Without moving forward, into a theory on the one hand, and quantification on the other hand, and the whole mathematical and statistical competence which mm-hmm. one expects mm-hmm. today.
Mm-hmm. Now, how do you see, you have a great interest, I suppose, in field work. And this is to start at the micro end. So
yes.
you get into the classroom with a globe to indicate mm-hmm. that scale, and then.
And then the following weekend, my colleague Eric Brown walks them in a long, long trail across a piece of country, 15 miles, kills them more or less, because they don't know how to walk anymore, I'm afraid.
Yes.
And it goes in through the soles of their feet, as it used to in the old days. And of course, the theories about the origins of the landscape are proclaimed and declared before them.
Yes.
All very dramatic. Because he walks along the Chiltern escarpment, you see, and introduces the whole concept of scarp retreat from the ground beneath their feet, and how long is it going to be before the piece of land where you are standing moves back. And I get on my horse and I go and charge up in front of them. And, it really is rather fun.
Yes.
Eric's first year, long, long trail of winding, we call it, uh-huh. you know, into the land of my dreams. You'll remember that song from the First World War.
I suppose you see more than an intellectual task of excursions.
Oh, very, very much, very much. My own little tutorial group, I always make them write 1,000 words on what their home place means to them. So that there is this whole feeling of place, territoriality too, because there is an emotional element here. I talk quite a lot about emotion, pedagogically, to my small tutorial mm-hmm. group. You can do this when you're three or four around a table, you see. Territoriality is dismissed as something not quite respectable, mm-hmm. not quite sensible, I suppose. But, you see, we don't talk political geography anymore, as they did in my remote days. And this business of the boundaries between countries and so on, the English people, maybe even Swedish people too, don't know what it means anymore to have had someone come and stand on their land and take mm-hmm. it away from them.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very sensitive from a purely Finnish point of view about this. I'm a bit of a Finn, naturally.
Yes, yes.
There's the other thing, you know, all over England, in their home place, their hometowns, I say, go to your market square and write a description of your market square. There is a war memorial, you see. They died for their country, their territory, their land, their mm-hmm. place.
Mm-hmm.
Takes me back to the London School of Economics. There was a wonderful man called Graham Wallace who wrote a book called Human Nature in Politics, which was compulsory reading when I was an undergraduate.
And political science, or?
Political science, yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, Human Nature in Politics was the book. And there was much geography in it. And he was mm-hmm. concerned with the concept of people's attachment to the place where they are born, the field, the church, the graveyard, you know, all this kind of thing. I'm very conscious of mm-hmm. this, very conscious personally.
Well, I think this is a good point to conclude, because mm-hmm. we are now taken back to your mm-hmm. childhood, when you walked in the fields with your father. And I suppose that this attachment to this particular piece of land is still a very important thing for you.
Well, naturally, I couldn't leave it in a state of retirement.
You couldn't?
No.
So, thank you very much.
Thank you.